historic Tombstone, Arizona. This 1880s silver mining boomtown was the location of some of the Old West's greatest stories and events. Today, when you visit the town that was too tough to die, it is a journey back in time. Join us as we visit the Birdcage Theater of historic Tombstone, Arizona.
I'm Bill Hunley, the owner of the Birdcage, sitting here in the old opera house in Tombstone, Arizona. The Birdcage is the oldest, most unique building, not only in Tombstone, but probably left of the Old West. In the 1880s, it operated around the clock, 24 hours a day. When Tombstone was a boom town of 18,500 people, the Birdcage never closed its doors. It was an opera house saloon, a combination of a gambling casino, a dance hall, stage, where the notorieties of the day, notables of the day, played the Birdcage. People such as Eddie Foy, Lotta Crabtree, Lily Langtry, all performed on this old stage behind me. The Birdcage was a site of 16 of Tombstone's shootings. There's over 140 bullet holes throughout the ceilings and walls of this famous old building. The Birdcage got its name from the famous song written about this building, The Bird in the Gilded Cage, which was a story about the little loaches and cribs that hang from the ceiling. And it's said that its writer mentioned to Eddie Foy that those girls upstairs in their scanty colored costumes and feathers in their hair were like birds in a gilded cage. They didn't have a chance. The gambling went on 24 hours a day here in the Birdcage, and some of the biggest high rollers of the West come to play in its games. The game in the basement run 24 hours a day for 8 years, 9 months, and 3 days, with over $1 million going to the house from its cut. Minimum buy-in was $1,000. Person many times would have to wait as much as a week after he paid his $1,000 to the house gaming steward to get into the game himself. High rollers such as Adolphus Busch and Hearst from the newspaper Hearst from the East all had mining properties here in Tombstone. All looked forward to playing in this game when they was in Tombstone on business. The Birdcage wasn't a place just for the average run-of-the-mill person. A miner could spend a month's salary in one night in this old building. The loges up above the Birdcage is rented from $25 to $40 a night. The music of the Birdcage was not only the best in Tombstone, but probably the best in the whole Southwest. Ed Wittick was the bandmaster. In the orchestra pit behind me, they had a five-piece orchestra. He was a graduate of the Conservatory of Music, and when he come west, the only position he could find to play was in a honky-tonk cabaret like the Birdcage. He became a legend in the less than 9 years that he performed here. Tombstone was a typical boomtown. Prices were elevated. Everything was based on the supply and demand. There was a big demand in the beginning, a very small supply, which elevated the price of everything. A miner made up to $5 a day. They paid in hard money at the end of each day. So 3,000 or 4,000 miners would go up the hill, work a shift, paid at the top of the hill, and as they were returning, the other shift was going up the hill, and the shift just getting off, work was coming down the hill, and the girls were waiting outside here on 6th Street to relieve them of their money. They used to refer to that as the anthill. They'd pay them on top of the hill and relieve them of their money at the bottom of the hill. And many, many times that was so true.
Ed Shefflin would discover silver that would bring thousands of miners to the Tombstone area. Prospecting in Apache country was dangerous, and the soldiers warned him that the only thing he'd find out in the hills was his tombstone. Ed continued his work and eventually found silver. Other miners flocked to the area and Tombstone was founded. Tombstone was a boomtown. Shefflin Hall was built by Ed's brother Al for the people of Tombstone in 1881. Ed died in Oregon on May 12, 1897. His last request was to be buried in the hills near the city of Tombstone. On May 23, 1897, Ed was laid to rest. This is his monument and gravesite near the city of Tombstone.
Some of the most famous characters of the Old West frequent the birdcage nightly. Wyatt Earp, Doc Holliday, Bat Masterson, Luke Short, the outlaw group, the Clantons, McLowrys, Curly Bill Brocious. As a matter of fact, Wyatt met Josephine here at the birdcage. She was performing here, and Wyatt was living right behind the birdcage in a covered wagon, he and his brothers, for about 18 months. Wyatt nightly would come into the birdcage and court Josie in her room below where she worked. Doc Holliday was here nightly. He dealt faro many times off the faro bank at the old faro table. And it was one night when Doc was dealing faro and his arch enemy, Johnny Ringo, either one cared for each other, come past the faro table, and Doc smiled and said, "Would you like to take a chance on bucking the tiger, Johnny?" Johnny, who was infuriated, trying to keep his cool, pulled his bandana off and said, "If you got the guts, Doc, how about grabbing a hold of this bandana? We'll get this on right now." Doc stood up and says, "Maybe this will be my lucky day." As he grabbed the bandana, they were both very inebriated, and he grabbed the bandana on one end and Johnny Ringo on the other. This was known as a handkerchief duel, which was one of the deadliest of all duels. Very few were ever fought because the proximity of the closeness, both firing approximately at the same time, most generally both people were killed. However, Wyatt grabbed Doc and Curly Bill grabbed Johnny Ringo. Just as they fired, they were so drunk they both missed. The shots are right below in the floor here.
The shootout at the OK Corral is the most famous gunfight in Western history. The lawmen included Wyatt Earp, his brothers Virgil and Morgan, and their friend Doc Holliday. The cowboys included Ike Clanton and his brother Billy, Tom McLowry and his brother Frank. Billy Claiborne was also with the cowboys. The lawmen walked down Fremont Street toward the vacant lot near the back of the OK Corral to disarm the unlawfully armed cowboys. The fight would take place between Fly's Photo Gallery and the now-gone Harwood House. Approximately 30 shots were fired and the fighting was over in 30 seconds. Billy Clanton with Tom and Frank McLowry were killed. They are buried at Boot Hill Cemetery. Ike Clanton was able to escape from the area by running through Fly's Photo Gallery. Billy Claiborne also ran from the area. Wyatt Earp was uninjured during the fight. Virgil had a bullet pass through his right calf muscle. Doc had a bullet deflected off of his holster on his right hip. This caused a minor injury. Morgan had a bullet enter through his right shoulder blade. It traveled across his back, breaking off a piece of his vertebrae, and exited out of his left shoulder blade. The lawman would be tried for murder in the old courthouse just across the street from the shootout area. Wyatt Earp and his group would be cleared of murder charges. The rivalry, shootings, and killings between the Earps and Cowboys would continue. Just before midnight on December 28, 1881, Virgil Earp exited the Oriental Saloon and walked across Fifth Street. As Virgil neared the Crystal Palace, he was shot twice by shotgun blasts. His left arm was permanently crippled. On March 18, 1882, Morgan Earp was shot. Morgan and Wyatt were in the Campbell and Hatch Saloon. Morgan was playing pool when shots were fired through the back door windows. A bullet entered Morgan's back and exited through his body, hitting another person in the saloon. Morgan died a short time later. Doc Holliday died on November 8, 1887 in Glenwood Springs, Colorado, from complications of tuberculosis. Ike Clanton would be killed on June 1, 1887 while running from lawmen out to arrest him for cattle theft. Billy Claiborne would be killed by buckskin Frank Leslie in front of the Oriental Saloon on November 14, 1882.
The building today still maintains its original paint on the ceiling from the 1880s. This wallpaper is all hand-painted. The lighting fixtures and chandeliers are still hanging, are original. Some have been electrified. In the 1880s, small tables and chairs was used throughout the building. The house gaming tables, such as the faro table, the dice table, the blackjack tables, and the roulette table, were centered under the overhangs along each side of the walls. But the center section of the auditorium here was tables and chairs. Originally, it was opened all the way into the bar room. So when you were standing at the bar, you were looking all the way through the building directly at the stage. The old bar and back bar is unique of Tombstone. In 1881, there was 106 saloons on Allen Street. The first fire of Tombstone destroyed 66 buildings. In 1881, the second fire, almost 1 year to the day of the first fire, destroyed 96 buildings. The bar and the back bar of the Birdcage is the only bar left of Old Tombstone in its original building and location from 1881. It's unique. It was built in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and shipped by boat around the Horn of South America to San Francisco and brought in by mule train into Tombstone, along with the piano behind me at the base of the stage here. It was also shipped. Everything in the days before the Panama Canal, everything had to be shipped around the Horn to one of two ports. The port in Mexico was Guaymas, and the port in the United States was primarily San Francisco. So then it had to be hauled almost 1,000 miles from San Francisco into Tombstone.
The Crystal Palace is one of the most famous saloons in Tombstone. This saloon was a frequent stop for most of Tombstone's infamous characters. The Crystal Palace displays some of the gaming artifacts used in its heyday. Today, visitors can still belly up to the bar as they did in the 1880s. The Crystal Palace Saloon in Tombstone, Arizona.
The Birdcage had several interesting ladies of the evening of many different reputations and from many different countries. Many French girls from France worked here, girls from Mexico, girls from all over the West. Many of these people knew each other from other Western towns before they come to Tombstone. Gold Dollar was a lady of the evening that worked on and off at the birdcage. And she would get into trouble, and then she would go to another house here in town. Margarita was a new, beautiful Mexican girl that was just started her employment here. And there was a tin horn gambler here at the birdcage by the name of Billy Milgreen. And Margarita thought he was something else. And so she started spending time with Billy. And Gold Dollar was working up the street. Gold Dollar was told that Margarita was seeing Billy on the side. So she come down and created a big scene in the bar room, threatening Margarita that if she caught her doing this again, she'd kill her. So a few days later, Margarita's sitting on the lap of Billy Milgreen, and someone tipped Gold Dollar off that what was going on at the birdcage. So in a flash, Gold Dollar run into the birdcage, pulled out a stiletto up in the bar room, and stabbed Margarita while she sat on Milgreen's lap. Well, there was a full house. 80, 90 people observed the stabbing in the bar, and she continued to try to cut her heart out. And she told her a few days before that she'd cut her heart out if she caught her again with Billy Milgreen. So someone yelled that the marshal was coming. When she heard the police was coming, she grabbed the stiletto, covered with blood. She ran through the birdcage, up the stairs to the stage, down the backstage stairs into the private poker room, which was filled. The game was going on. She ran past about 15 other people out the back door. She was arrested across the street at Toughnut, almost at Toughnut and Fifth Street, by the old firehouse. But she didn't have the murder weapon. Somewhere between the birdcage and the firehouse, which is a distance of about 100 feet, the murder weapon had disappeared. She had hid it somewhere. Well, you will find out that in many places of the Old West, in all the towns of the Old West, when there was scandal or murder or mayhem that occurred in one of the places of the night that had ladies of the night, very little was ever printed about this, because it was these establishments that was frequented by everybody, all the men of the community, from the prominent to the non-prominent. So most generally, if somebody was shot in a house of ill repute, the body was taken outside to the closest side street or an alley, and it was reported that the next day that they were found in that alley. They didn't want to publicize this happening also, and so they told Gold Dollar that if she left town, since they didn't have a murder weapon, that if she left town, no charges would be brought against her. So she and Billy, in the middle of the night, left Tombstone. She was never to return. He returned a few months later. They laid Margarita to rest, of course, in Boot Hill Cemetery, where she lays today. One of the most famous love triangles of the Old West all started right here at the birdcage. And that was the love triangle between Johnny Behan, the sheriff of Cochise County, and his lover and live-in lady, Sarah Josephine Marcus, and Wyatt Earp, who was deputy sheriff in the beginning of Pima County. This was part of Pima County. Josephine had come to Tombstone with Johnny Behan. They built a house on Fremont Street, and she, every time Johnny would be out on his duties as the sheriff, she'd wind up working back in the birdcage and sometimes entertaining on the stage. Wyatt and her was love almost, they say, at first sight. And Wyatt was living just behind the birdcage with his wife at that time, Maddie Blaylock. So it was convenient for him to tell his wife he was going to gamble that night at the birdcage, walk up to Allen Street in the front door, and she was sleeping in their covered wagon just 50 feet behind the back door. The room in the basement is still very much the way that the love affair was carried on, in the basement of the birdcage. The original furnishings and all the drapes and the furnishings are still intact from that day. If those walls could only talk, what stories they could tell.
While in Tombstone, Wyatt Earp would meet his future wife, Josephine Sarah Marcus. Josephine Sarah Marcus was from San Francisco and first came to Tombstone in 1879 to work in the theaters. The two would leave Tombstone and travel the West for the rest of their lives. Wyatt died in Los Angeles, California on January 13, 1929. Josephine died on December 19, 1944. They are buried together in Colma, California, just south of San Francisco.
The birdcage houses many artifacts of some of the first pioneers of Tombstone, the famous and the infamous. They've been laying in this old building, some of them for 120 years. But the birdcage itself is a walk into time. It's an experience. If there was not an artifact in this building, it would be an experience just to walk where they fell, where they played, where they gambled. One of the most unique artifacts of the birdcage is the old Tombstone Boot Hill hearse that was owned by the Watt and Tarbell Undertaking Parlors. It's on display on the backstage. It's trimmed in 24 karat gold and sterling silver. It cost $8,000 to purchase in 1881. There were only eight of them made. It was used to bury everyone that was in Boot Hill Cemetery, with the exception of five people. The hearse was used in Tombstone from 1881 until the first motorized vehicles around 1917.
The Boot Hill Cemetery. The most famous grave site is that of Billy Clanton and Tom and Frank McLowry. These three were killed during the gunfight at the OK Corral. On October 27, 1880, on the vacant lot that the birdcage now occupies, Curly Bill Brocious shot and killed Marshal Fred White. Fred White is buried at Boot Hill Cemetery. Here lies Lester Moore, four slugs from a 44. No less, no more. This is the gravesite of Lester Moore. Miss An Lam, or also known as China Mary, she ran the Chinese section of town. No Chinese in town did anything for you unless she approved it. She is also buried here at Boot Hill. There are many other grave sites here at Boot Hill, many known and many unknown.
Fatima actually performed at the birdcage. She was a belly dancer in the first year of its operation. She left and went on to San Francisco, and that where the large painting that hangs in the bar room today is, that painting was made in San Francisco, and she sent it back to the owners. And they hung it on that wall in 1882, and it's hung there reflecting into the bar mirror across the bar room floor for all those years. There's six bullet holes in that painting and a knife slash. Fatima's seen a lot of things that happened in the birdcage. Of course, Tombstone was the largest city between St. Louis and San Francisco. It was on the entertainment circuit. The greatest performers of the day, the big performers of the day, were traveling from New York to the West Coast. Tombstone, being a city of 18,000 people, boosted two theaters. The Birdcage was a burlesque honky-tonk type of theater where Shefflin Hall was a legitimate Gilbert and Sullivan type of theater. The New York Times' byline was, the Birdcage was the roughest, wildest, wickedest place between Basin Street and the Barbary Coast in 1882. But the birdcage was guest to many great performers, such as Eddie Foy, the great Eddie Foy, Lotta Crabtree, Lily Langtree, Maude Adams, Lolo Montez, were just a few that played here. The birdcage had its nightly entertainment, which was its can-can line, its French circuit can-can line that danced nightly on the stage, along with its risque entertainment for the male gender. When big performers come to Tombstone, such as Eddie Foy and Lotta Crabtree, they were booked also, but their nightly entertainment was primarily the can-can line and the risque entertainment for the male gender.
Here are just a few of the ladies that worked at the Birdcage Theater during its heyday.
The red-coated bartenders of the Birdcage poured nothing but the finest in Tombstone at the Cherrywood Bar out front. It's amazing, the drinks that was so popular at the time. We think of the cowboy coming up and getting a shot of whiskey. But actually, in the Birdcage, mixed drinks was very popular. The drink of the day was the whiskey sour. The martini was a new drink on the scene. And a pink squirrel, of all things. Their beers were all Bavarian beers, with the exception of Budweiser. Budweiser was the only American beer sold in the Birdcage. Their wines were all French wines, and nothing but the finest Kentucky bourbons was used in this house. One of the more flamboyant characters of the Birdcage was Russian Bill. Come to Tombstone, probably was the first dude of Tombstone, with yellow chaps, pearl-handled nickel-plated Colts, and fancy boots and a big white 10-gallon hat. He had long blonde hair like Custer, and he spoke excellent English, the King's English, with a Russian accent. And Bill he spent money like it was going out of style. He rented that one bloach or that one box for 2 years at $25 a night. He played both sides against the middle. He liked the lawmen such as the Earps, but he really liked the outlaws. He was intrigued with Curly Bill, Johnny Ringo, and that bunch that was rustling cattle and stealing horses and robbing stagecoaches. And he hung out with them a lot. Matter of fact, he wanted to ride with them, and they didn't quite trust this dude that talked funny. And so they told him that if he could prove he was an outlaw, maybe he could ride with them. So he goes over to the town of Shakespeare, which is a ghost town today, and he steals a horse. Unfortunately, he was caught and tried right there in Shakespeare and hanged from the old hotel, in the lobby of the old hotel, along with two other men. So, as the story went, they laid Bill to rest. And about six months later, a United States Marshal rode into Tombstone asking if anyone knew about the whereabouts of the description of this character known as Russian Bill. And come to find out that he was actually a prince from the royal family of Russia. He was a Romanov. And he had been sent as a courier from Russia to Boston to pick up some money for the family on a business transaction. Well, the lure of the West got him, and he decided before he went back to Russia, he'd take a trip through the West. He wound up in Tombstone, wound up stealing a horse, and was hanged. Well, diplomatic relations was very important even in that day. So they immediately sent a telegram from Tombstone to the governor of the Arizona Territory, which sent that telegram on to the president of the United States, which was sent on to Russia. The telegram read, "We're very sorry to state that this individual by the name of William Romanoff departed from this earth March 14th, 1883. His death was attributed to a broken neck caused from a fall from high altitude." When the great Eddie Foy, who was the biggest comedian, the biggest performer of his day, was playing the Birdcage, he was showed a song about this building that a minstrelist who was playing on the bill also had written. Foy, who talked out of the side of his mouth, said, "Well, Ned," said, that's a song that a man can't sing. It's a song for a woman." And Ned had told him that this place reminded him of a birdcage, the way the girls in their scanty collared costumes and feathers in their hair in the private birdcages upstairs were like birds in a gilded cage. So that afternoon he wrote a song and he offered it to Foy, but Foy said that was for a woman to sing. So as the story goes, he gave it to this unknown young singer, performer, who was playing on the bill also that night. And she brought the house down when she introduced it off this stage. They had planned to call this building the Elite Theater, or the Elite Opera House Saloon. Well, after she had an encore of the song two or three times, the next day they decided to call this place the Birdcage. The song was "The Bird in the Gilded Cage." It became the number one hit of the 19th century and one of the most popular hits of the 19th century. And she went on to become one of the biggest performers of the American theater. Her name was Lillian Russell. The Birdcage was a unique operation in the 1880s. It operated 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for almost 9 years. When the mines in the town of Tombstone closed, so to speak, overnight, the Birdcage was closed and boarded up. They thought it was for only a short time, perhaps 6 weeks, 6 months. So all the furnishings was covered in drapes and canvases. Even the liquor was left in the wine cellars. The 6 weeks went to 6 months, went to almost 50 years that this building stood sealed and boarded up. Then in 1934, as many movies were being made, motion pictures from Hollywood here in many of the ghost towns of Arizona and Tucson, this old building was open to the public as a National Historic Site, which it has remained now since 1934. That's one of the reasons that it's so well preserved. It's a walk back into time, definitely. The Birdcage is not a restoration, it's a preservation. The main object of this building and for its future is to do everything we can to keep it preserved in its original state, as you see it today. That's what truly makes it a walk into time. There's many, many memories of the Old West in this building and many spirits of the Old West.
The antiques in the Birdcage are an incredible part of Tombstone history. This music box was built in Germany in 1841. It has been in the Birdcage since 1881. Let's listen to the music that was played in the Birdcage Theater. Historic Tombstone, Arizona, and the Birdcage Theater. The preservation of the birdcage and the artifacts it houses are priceless American treasures. The Birdcage Theater of Tombstone, Arizona, a walk back in time.
Basically, this one's filling you like while you're prepping. And then you get in the back room and you go to the door. I have a whole door and a frame of so on.
Okay. You ever got one? Mm-hmm.
This is a good shot for me. Okay, that's good. Oh, okay, that's keep going.
Curly Bill. Yeah, with the best job anybody could have.
Oh, no, you won't be able to move it, Bill. I think it's screwed down.
No, just a little.